this moment. Close your eyes. We're just going to open up in prayer and ask the Lord's blessing on us here today. Father, we thank you. We thank you so much for that time of worship. And Father, I just pray this morning that you will saturate this place with the presence of Jesus. That the sense of Jesus would be in this room. That Jesus, you would show yourself for who you are. That you would hide us. Hide our names. Hide who we are. And only put you at the forefront of our minds. God, it's our mission to lift up the name of Jesus Christ. We just ask you, God, this morning, that many in this room will hear the word of the Lord. And it will go deep down within their soul. It will not just be in the minds. It won't just be knowledge. But it will be revelation. That by your Holy Spirit, you will bring it from our minds down into our lives so it can be seen. It can be seen. That the fruit of each one of us would be the fruit of the Spirit. And we know in our own flesh, in our own strength, in our own abilities, we can't produce the life of God ourselves. We can't get ourselves through this life, this journey, this difficult, hard path that we're all on. We can't do it on our own. And every one of us needs to be picked up, oh God, to be carried through this life and sometimes throughout our days, Lord, because it's only you that can bring us to the finish line. And I'm asking you, Jesus, by your grace and your mercy, that you would be glorified this morning and that you would be high and lifted up. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So if you've noticed with me since we began, we've actually been working through 1 Samuel chapter 1, and we've been going through the entire book of 1 Samuel. And I'm going to put somebody on the spot here this morning. Who in this room has taken time this week to follow along in the reading of 1 Samuel? Maybe you read the first chapter or the second chapter or the third chapter of 1 Samuel just to find out what it is that I've been talking about. Anybody in this room? Wow. Thank you guys so much. Thank you. That is amazing. Thank you for following along in 1 Samuel. I'm so proud to see that. I want to really encourage you to take a couple of moments. It's a really easy read. It's a very quick read. But as you get through it, you'll be like, oh, so that's what he was talking about when he talked about Hannah and the little baby that was born. Well, that's what he was talking about Samuel, who heard the voice of God and stood up and spoke out the word of God in such power, even from a very young age. The Bible is one of the most amazing books. It will pull you in, and as you read through it, you'll start applying it to your life. It will start giving you wisdom. It will start giving you guidance. It will start giving you direction. The Bible will even start mapping out your future and where you should go and how you make decisions. Decision making is so important. We all have different ways of making decisions. But the greatest way that anybody could ever make a decision is to follow how the Bible tells us to make a decision. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 through 6, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." A lot of times we make decisions, but we're not including God in our decision making. We're not bringing God in on our decision making. We will bring our friends in on our decision about what college we're going to go to, about what girlfriend we're going to have, about what we're going to do in the future, or about what career we want to be. We'll bring our friends in it, but very few will ever actually include God in their decision-making process. And the problem with that is God knows better than what we do for our own lives. If we would start bringing God in on all of the areas of our lives, not just when it comes to when we need him, but also also when it comes to the rest of our life and bringing God in, not just on before we eat our food, but bringing God in on all of the things that we go through in life. Letting God know about your tears. Letting God know about your brokenness. Letting God know about your pain. Letting God know about all the things that you're facing in life. I know for me, that has been what's brought me to this point in my life. You know, growing up in Ireland, it's a small, tiny island. It's only got around 3 million people that live on the island. It's small. It's smaller than big cities in America. It's way smaller than probably Jacksonville would be. I bet you could fit the entire city of Jacksonville and the population of it onto the island of Ireland. That's how small Ireland is. When I grew up in Ireland, we had such limited access to things compared to what your generation have today. It's a completely different world. It's a different world. And I knew from a young age, because of going to church and because of getting my heart saved at the age of 6 years old, that I needed to include Jesus in all the decisions that I would make in my life. And I can tell you to this very day that the decisions I made in my life without consulting God, without including God, without praying to God, even as a believer in Jesus, I make mistakes. I have regrets. I wish I should have. I wish I could have. All because I simply would not follow the scripture in terms of it telling me the direction that I need to go in. Now Samuel was one that would listen for the voice of God. Samuel, as a young man, was one that actually followed and listened throughout the entirety of his ministry. When you read the history of this young man in 1 Samuel in the Bible, when you read the entire book, you're going to be shocked. He was a man that followed God all the time. He just followed God. It's as if from a young age, he was sold out and he knew no different, and all he wanted was God. Even though he was from a broken situation. And sometimes we think, because we're in the situation we're in, that it's going to be the way it is right now forever. And the enemy in our minds will magnify what we're going through and magnify the pressures and the circumstances that we're facing to the point where it's so magnified, it becomes bigger than God. It becomes bigger than the power of God. But I want you to know here today that the real battle for you and I as we go through this life is that we don't magnify what we see or what we feel bigger than God is. Because there's nothing too difficult for God to bring you through this life. There's nothing bigger than God that he can't fix in your life. There's nothing bigger than God that he can't heal you with and give you strength to get through. And I can tell you that from experience, because of the trials and the difficulties and the hardships that I could go in on and make everyone here in this room feel sorry for me for what I faced in life. Or I can say to you, look at the Bible and look at the historical accounts of all the men and women, young men and young women, throughout history, that God saw them through to the end. That God saw them through to the end. I'm going to show you something here right now that I believe is going to be very practical. Because up until this point, we've been talking a lot about the love of God and theology and talking about, you know, emotional and experiential. And we're talking about all these different things about how we need to have a relationship with God. And sometimes people say to me, that's so out there in the clouds. It's so distant. I need something practical. I need something I can put my hands on. You're telling me to pray, but when it comes to prayer, I don't even know what to say. You're talking to me about how I need to have a relationship with God, but I don't even know how to have a relationship with friends. I don't know how to talk to people. And I got something here that I believe can really encourage you, strengthen you, but also be a practical tool to get you into a deeper relationship with God. This little black box that I'm holding right here, you can pick it up at Walmart or Office Depot. And inside this black box, there is 400 scriptures that I started memorizing back in Bible school. Each card simply has the scripture reference on the front and the scripture on the back. And I go through these every week. It takes around an hour and a few minutes. And I simply read the reference, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. Let's see if I can do this. Come unto me, all of you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon thee and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Whoa, I just did it. It's not an easy thing to do. It's not an easy thing to do. And sometimes you look at, oh man, he's got 400. And some people go away, well, I'm going to learn 10 this week. But if I was to ask you a question here today, how do you eat an elephant? Can't eat an elephant as a whole elephant because none of our mouths are big enough to squeeze an elephant into our mouths. So if I was to ask you, how do you eat an elephant? You eat it one bite at a time. How do you know what scripture to memorize? Maybe you're at camp and this week you just got saved and hearing about the Bible in your small groups, hearing about the Bible up here. And now you're hearing about memorizing the Bible, memorizing some part of the Bible. I believe, personally, the way I've memorized the Word of God is by looking, whether on Google or with a counselor or with a pastor, for a scripture that you need right now in your life. Maybe you're going through a really difficult time. And you've just been telling yourself over and over, it's going to be okay. I'm going to get through this. I'm going to get through this. And staying positive and keeping positive thoughts in your mind. And in this room, you've been trying to keep your mind on that, but it's not been enough. It's not really been enough. Because we can be as positive as we can be in our minds, but if that positivity is not backed up with some type of solid truth that can truly give you the confidence that you need to say to yourself in the mirror, I'm going to get through this. It's not over for me. It's not going to be this way forever. Then that truth in scripture will carry you further. For example, Philippians chapter 4 verse 13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That would be a great verse for somebody in this room just to memorize this week and say, listen, that verse only has 7 or 8 words in it. And I'm going to take that one verse like Adam, and I'm going to write it on a piece of paper, and I'm going to memorize that verse, and I'm going to get that verse deep down within my soul. You see, Samuel, as he was a young man serving Eli and serving the religious system of that day, he was brought up on memorizing the Word of God. It was a custom in their day to just memorize the entirety of the Bible at that time in the Old Testament. Now that is way too much for any of us, especially me, to ever memorize. Listen, there was times in junior high and even in elementary school, I didn't even know how to write my name. I couldn't even remember anything. I was so bad at school, it's unbelievable when I was in elementary school. So bad, so bad. All I was good at was sports. But when it came to school and memorizing things, I really struggled with it. It wasn't until I went to Bible school and I heard a preacher talk like I'm talking to you, where the preacher said that if you will surrender your mind to God and you will include God in your decision making and you will say to God, have your way in my life, you will start doing things that you could never do on your own or before you started praying that way to God. So I want to invite you to start really raising the bar on what you think you can or cannot do. Maybe you're in here and you're thinking to yourself, I can't do that. I can't do this. I can't do that. I can't do this. And your mind is full of what you can't do. You see, as a believer or as a new believer, you've got to get those words out of your vocabulary and out of your minds. There is no I can't for you, and there is no I can't for me. If God calls us to it, then we can do it. If God leads us to it, then we're able to follow through, because He will always complete the work that He starts in your life, even at a young age. I want to encourage you, maybe to this week, let it be the start. Let it be the start for you to begin to memorize the Word of God. As you notice, when I'm preaching over the last couple of days, I don't have many notes. I'm able to pull from the scriptures that I've memorized, and I'm able to communicate to you all off of memory the Word of God, because it's in me. But it's also not just in me because I memorize His Word. I'm going to show you another tool, because a lot of times young people don't realize that preachers actually have a toolbox, just like a mechanic, just like a doctor, just like anyone else in their profession. They've got a toolbox. And today, I'm going to show you some of the tools, because I know Samuel was taught these things and these simple disciplines when he was a young man. And I want you today, no matter what it is that you're going through, to believe that you too can rise up and memorize His Word today. And realize you don't have to rely on positive thinking, but you can rely on a positive scripture that can give you hope and give you peace long after this camp is over. What you're looking at here, friends, is a simple journal, a simple journal. It says 2020 on it. For the last nearly 16 years, I've been writing in journals. This particular journal is actually every day of the week. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And I keep it short. It's only one page per day. And I keep it really short. And inside of these journals, listen carefully, you will read of my relationship with the Lord. Because in these journals, when I write these journals, I don't go just writing off for the sake of writing. I don't write it to so-and-so. I communicate better in writing than I do in talking. Maybe you're in here today and you've struggled with relationships, or you've been struggling with a relationship with God. You've been struggling with prayer. You're like, when it comes to prayer, I don't know what to say. I want to encourage that person that's in this room today to begin to try to write out your prayers, write out your pain, write out your sorrow, write out your joy, write out your hopes, write out your dreams, write out your desires. You will be amazed as you begin to write on paper to God all of the things that you're going through, how it will radically help you process all the things in life that we go through. That's why we have the Bible. One of the greatest examples of someone that journaled and someone that wrote out their heart is someone that we're going to talk about later on this week. But young Samuel was not only the one to call out Eli and Phinehas and Hophni. Young Samuel also was used by God to anoint a king named David. And David was one in the Psalms who wrote out his heart. The Psalms is a great book in the Bible. If you don't know where to start in the Bible, and you're so new to the Bible, you're so new to everything, reading the Psalms will really show you the type of relationship that God is willing to have with you and with me. Because we see David writing out his sweat, his tears, his blood, his pain, all the things that David went through. We see it throughout the writings of the book of Psalms. I want to encourage you, friends. Journaling is not for a weak person. Journaling, you know, when I grew up, people that kept journals were seen as just, because we were part of sports, it just wasn't seen as something that somebody does. But I want to encourage you. I started journaling just because at Bible school, a man named David Wilkerson journaled, and I thought it was a cool thing, so I'm going to start journaling. Now I'm reliant on journaling in terms of me being able to communicate to God what it is that's going on in my soul. You see, friends, to be a follower of Jesus and to follow Jesus will come with a responsibility for you to either allow yourself to grow in God and grow in your relationship with God, or for you to check out of God and say, well, I got saved this week and that's it. I just want to go to heaven. That's it. Not realizing that God wants to be with you long after this week is over. God wants to be with you as you make decisions in this next school semester, as you're making decisions for your future, as you're making decisions about what you're going to be doing in your life. God wants to be near to you through all of those things. That God is not just distant and far away and wants to just see you in heaven one day, but God is near to you. God is close to you. God wants to walk with you, and God wants to bring you through this life. Now I want to read 1 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 3, and the scripture is up on the screen. Samuel said to all the house of Israel, if you are returning to the Lord with all your heart, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtoreth from among you, and direct your heart to the Lord and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines. So the people of Israel put away the Baals and the Ashtoreth, and they served the Lord only. Yesterday we saw how Samuel called out Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas and said to them, your time is up. It's over for you. And you can read on in the story and see what happens to them. But all of them truly do end. The word that Samuel said came true. In fact, young Phinehas' wife had a little baby, and the little baby was called Ichabod. It was like the glory of God had left that generation because they weren't open to God. They weren't willing to be used of God. They weren't allowing God to speak into their lives. Now we have Samuel not only dealing with a few people that were around him. Now young Samuel is dealing with the entire nation of Israel. Can you imagine in this room, one of you hearing from God? And God gives you a word, and gives you word not just for yourself to get you through life, but to get others a word that can get them through life. And then giving you another word that can get this entire nation through life. I want you to know that you can be a world changer. A world changer. And right now in your mind, you're so focused on the problem and the circumstance that it's become this giant mountain in your mind, and you can't see what's on the other side of it. But Jesus has the power to cast mountains into oceans. I remember walking on Pensacola Beach, and I was crying out to God as I was walking the beach for a situation that was very dire and very bad. And I didn't know the outcome of this situation. I didn't know what way my life, my situation was about to go. It was really bad, without going into specifics. And the problem that I was facing was so huge in my mind, so big in my mind, I couldn't see any hope, any light at the end of the tunnel. I couldn't see any way through it. And I looked down onto the beach and I heard the gentle whisper of God in my soul saying to me, look at a grain of sand. So I bent down and I picked up a grain of sand and I looked at the grain of sand. This tiny grain of sand. And it struck me. This life, while we're here on earth, is like that grain of sand compared to, now look at the beach, trillions of grains of sand, trillions upon trillions of grains of sand. Look at what's ahead. And something happened in my mind because my mind was so weighed down. It was so under pressure. It was so dark in my mind. I couldn't see any hope. And then all of a sudden, the largeness of God and the future that God has for each one of us. And what is ahead from this life? All of a sudden in my mind now, the problem started getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. And the excitement and the goodness and the adventure and what is ahead began to get bigger, bigger, bigger and bigger. Right now in your mind, I want you to take the thoughts that are bringing you down and with your mind's eye, say, I'm looking away from those and I'm looking to the hope of what God has for my life. God has a way of making mountains into grains of sand to give us hope and to give us a future. Now, many of you know I'm a really passionate person. I'm so passionate. I get passionate about food. You should see me when I get a steak. I get passionate about that steak. You should see me when there's some ribs on the grill. I get passionate about some ribs. You should see me when it comes to a double Whopper from Burger King. I devour a Whopper all day long. I love Whoppers. Extra cheese, please. You should see me when it comes to food. I'm a food type of person. I don't know what to do with myself when I'm around food. I just fall apart. My jaw opens up, saliva pours out, and I don't know what to do with myself. I just can't wait to get some food in my tummy. I love food. I'm passionate. I'm passionate about sports. I'm passionate about lots of different things. And how many of you think I'm passionate about Jesus? This guy's really passionate. But I want you to know something. Passion has got nothing to do with godliness. Just because I'm passionate, it's not anything to do with godliness. It's not anything. Well, do I have to be as passionate as he is if I want to be a Christian and follow Jesus? Do I have to be like him? I got good news for you. I'm not anybody that you want to be like. You see, someone much smarter than me said this, that all we are as preachers is beggars, just beggars that need bread ourselves, telling everyone else, hey, I found bread this morning, and it was in the presence of Jesus. I didn't get much sleep last night. I don't know about you, but I was tossing and turning. I didn't get much sleep last night. And the whole time last night, all I could say was, Jesus, I want you to get glory for my life. I want you to be known. I want you to be seen. I want you to be lifted up. And I want you to know here today that this is really the direction that the Lord wanted me to share with you, is that God can get glory out of your life and use you like Samuel was used to preach a message that can change your situation, and not only your situation, but also the nation. I want you to know something about Samuel when he preached. It's really interesting when you read the verse that we just read. He says, hey, if you all really want to follow God, if you all really want the blessing of God, because up until this point, Israel had lost the Ark of the Covenant. They had lost a lot of their treasures. They had lost their vision. They had lost their passion for God. And Samuel was being used by God to bring that nation, Israel, back to God. And he says, if you really want to follow God, Samuel says, then you must turn away from the idolatry. You need to turn away from those things that have grabbed your attention, that have brought you down, that have been magnified bigger than Jesus and been glorified bigger than Jesus and have become larger than Jesus in your mind and in your life. You see, friends, when it comes to repentance, when it comes to saying sorry, when it comes to, and many of you this week, I saw it. I've never seen anything like it. Like the first Monday night, watching all you young guys and young girls flooding this front, watching many of you get down on your knees. I saw in this room teenagers weeping and wiping the tears from their faces as they're doing business and getting real with God. For me, I was stepping back and going, what is about to happen in this room? Something mega, something huge is about to happen in this room. Yesterday morning, when we talked about different sins and how we can bring them to God and how He has the power to not only forgive us, but change us and make us born again and give us fruit, so the fruit in our life will be obvious that we are followers of Jesus Christ. Last night, talking about the greatest miracle that God has ever done for mankind, which is to bring us into a relationship with God, bring us back into a relationship with Him where we can hear His voice. Like Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. And watching many of you come forward last night to say, God, I want to hear the voice of God. Did anybody hear the voice of God last night? Let me see your hand. Lift it up good and high. Wow. So many heard clearly that they're important. So many heard clearly that God is calling for your life. Purpose for you. A future for you. A direction for your life. And I was so moved because I know that this is probably one of the hardest generations to be born into. I can't imagine right now, if I was your age, how I would be dealing with all of the things that are going on in our world today. It's a hard time to be alive for all of us. But watching your hunger for God, watching your desire for God has just increased my hope and my vision to see a massive coming back to Jesus in our generation. You all are the answer to my children's generation. You all are the answer to my children's children's generation. There'll be someone in this room one day standing up here preaching to you like I am, because you are going to be raised up to be a communicator for God, a Samuel for God, a one that speaks on behalf of God. Right now, in this moment of time, as we just read in Samuel, that our response to God can't just be emotional. We can't just say, yes, God, we want you, we want to come back to you, and then get up off our knees or walk right on out this place and live like it never happened. Samuel's saying, if this is real, look at me in the eyes. If this is real, Samuel's saying, if this is real, if what God is doing in you is real, then turn away from all the time of playing video games and turn to the Word of God to memorize it. Then turn away from all of the entertainment that distracts us while we're sitting down just playing on games to get away from everything that's going on in our lives. And let's turn to things that can actually get us through this life. That can actually give us hope through this life. That can actually give us vision through this life, that can actually give us power, true power, to make it through this. And I'm going to close with just reading chapter 8 and verse 6 to you right now. It says this: Samuel, verse 6 says, "But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, 'Give us a king to judge us.' And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to him, 'Obey the voice of the people in that day, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them.'" Samuel, who preached, who was used so powerfully by God, now has been asked by the nation of Israel, "Give us a king. Give us a man. Oh, if we just had a man, if we just give us a king, give us somebody that can get us through this life." And for Samuel, it hurt him on his heart. He was displeased with it because up until this point in Israel, God ruled Israel. God was their king. But Israel did not want to have a relationship with God as a corporate group of people. Israel wanted a man that would mediate between them and God. And Samuel was really upset. How many of you ever get upset? He was really upset. And God said to Samuel, "We're going to give them a king. We're going to give them what they want. They don't want a relationship with me. They would much rather a preacher or a counselor or a pastor. But they don't want to know me. They don't want to know me. I'm here to tell you right now that the only relationship that will ever be enough to get you through this life is your relationship with God." Some of you think, if I just had a relationship with my pastor, or if I just had a relationship with that man of God, if I had a relationship with this person, if I could just get through this life as friends with so-and-so, if I was in that group, or if only I was born into that family, I wish I had a family like them. I wish I had parents like that. If I had it like that, things wouldn't be the way it is for me right now. And the grass is always greener on the other side, because there's truly only one that can get our soul through this life, and it is Jesus. And Jesus is inviting you today to say, "Jesus, I want you to be my king. I want you to be my pastor. I want you to be my shepherd. Jesus, I want to start including you in my decision-making process. I want to start including you. You're more important than any man or any person to me, Jesus. I need you more than church. I need you more than songs. I need you more than all of my disciplines. I need you more than anything else. Jesus, I need you." And I'm telling you right now, friends, when Jesus becomes your focus, when Jesus has your attention, when you just want Jesus more than anything else, you will find the comfort, the peace, the joy that you always wanted. If you stand to your feet here today, maybe you're here this morning and you could say, Adam, I've come up to the front, but Adam, it's not really led to any type of real change in my life. I've lifted up my hand, Adam, and felt goosebumps, but it hasn't really led to any real change in my life. Jesus is here today, not only to make you feel good about your situation right now, but Jesus is here to wrap his arms around you, to look at you in the eyes and to tell you that he cares about you, and he cares about your situation, and he cares about what you're going through. And your pastors and your counselors that are here, they're the hands and feet of Jesus. and they are to show you his love and his kindness and compassion. And listen, we are just humans. If you look to pastors and counselors as we are Jesus to you, we're going to disappoint you. I'm going to disappoint you. The last thing I ever want to do is disappoint or offend or upset anybody. Because I love everybody. And I've spent time with anybody. And in my own weakness and in my own futility and in my own abilities, I can't do what Jesus can for your soul. But I know that Jesus has his arms around me and I can sense his love and his embrace. And I want you to know that the hands of Jesus are wide open to take you in, to love on you the same. I'm no different than anyone else in this room. I need Jesus as much as anybody else in this room. And so I want to invite you today. If you're saying, God, I want to step out of my seat to show my friends, I'm going to make a decision to start memorizing a verse of the Bible this week. I'm going to step out of that seat today, and I'm going to make a decision to write out a prayer. Write out, find a blank piece of paper, take a pen, and write out your heart to God. I'm going to make a decision to do that this week. I want you to leave your seat right now, and I want you to come up here to me. Let me see you. Come on. It's a tough one, I know, and it's not for everybody. But you're going to come up here. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. You don't have to kneel down or anything like that. The reason why I'm asking you to come forward is because I really want to encourage you today, to really encourage you today. And I want your counselors to see each and every one of you. And I want your counselors to know who you are that have made a decision to say, you know, I want to start, instead of just having positive thoughts, I want power in my mind to overcome the negative thoughts. And I want to memorize just one verse of the Bible, even if it's the shortest verse that I can find that will best help me get through this life. And I'm telling you something, you start quoting that verse, Philippians 4:13 is a powerful verse to memorize. And it goes like this, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you can say it over, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I want you all that have responded to come up here to be really open to a counselor or to a pastor to come alongside you and say, hey, what scripture did you memorize? Did you memorize? And maybe you say, well, I'm not sure about what scripture. Hey, can I help you with a scripture? I can help you with one. Let's talk about what you're going through right now. Are you going through a tough time? Let's find a scripture that can get you through tough times. A scripture that you can write it down on your desk at home, on the refrigerator. Put it in your wallet or in your purse or in your pocket. And something that you can pull out at any time throughout your day. And you can read that scripture and say, my thoughts are telling me bad things and telling me it's not going to work out for me. But this scripture is giving me hope and it's giving me a future. And it's not going to be the way it is right now forever. Is there anyone else out here today that would like to step forward just so your counselors can see you and they can press in alongside you and help you? Anyone else here today that wants to step forward and say, I want to step out because I want to memorize his word. I want to memorize just one verse if I can. Or I want to write out a prayer to God. Many of you probably already do this. Now, those that are here right now with me, can the counselors that are here just lift up your hands across the back here for a moment? Can you students turn around and walk your way back to some of these counselors? Just go to the counselor that you know or that you've been a friend with or that you've connected with this week. And these counselors are just going to talk to you very briefly about a scripture that you can memorize, about taking you deeper in a relationship with God. And just in this moment, can we sing a song of praise? Is that okay? Sing a song of worship. Do you mind all just closing your eyes just for a moment of time? And Let's just get our attention on the Lord while those students are interacting. You can actually sit down if you want and just relax. We're just going to sing a word of blessing over your life. Try to sing out the song if you can. Let's sing it out if you can, if you know the words.
Coming after me, there's no shadow now. Snow shadow, you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up. Coming after me, there's no wall.